More from Kasabian and the Pretenders with Friday night's extended Litter with Jules Holland at 11.35. Now though on BBC Two Northern Ireland, in a Change to the Build episode, Richard Wilson discovers another of Britain's best drives.
For many, the 1950s were the golden age of British motoring. Back then, driving was leisurely, liberating and fun. Yes, things have changed a bit since then. But perhaps it's still possible to recapture some of that old magic.
Oh, yes.
I'm setting off on six of the best drives from the 1950s, as recommended by the guidebooks of the era. And I'll be driving them in some of the decade's most iconic vehicles.
Going into reverse.
I want to find out if these routes still thrill and inspire.
This is a spectacular road.
And how in 50 years Britain itself has changed.
Oh, for God's sake. They wouldn't have thought to come here without a sat nav.
I'm sure they wouldn't.
They would not value each other as much as they did then.
It was a different type of life, wasn't it?
Britain has no range as high as the Alps or the Pyrenees, yet its mountain scenery on a miniature scale is just as impressive. The mountains of Wales have a real character of their own, a rugged grandeur and an intimate beauty out of all proportion to their actual physical height.
So here we are in North Wales, driving a Ford Zodiac, 1957. This car was made, and because it was made in 1957, you're exempt from wearing seat belts.
When the Zodiac was launched onto the British roads in 1955, it must have seemed to meet author and Welsh language expert Bethan Gwanus to find out more. But despite my obvious reluctance, the director seems obsessed with filming in the most precipitous possible places.
You think, you know, you do a driving program, heights won't come into it.
No.
And I don't quite know why he's so amused at the thought of me plummeting from the parapets.
Oh, that's a funny image. Rocking back with laughter.
Thanks, Neil. At least you didn't lose your bloody job. So, Bethan, here we are in Carnarvon Castle, above the cloud line. Isn't it true that, as I've heard from a guide today, that the Welsh weren't allowed in this castle?
No.
That's extraordinary.
I know. Edward I built this castle when his soldiers killed our last crown prince, Llywelyn Ap Gruffydd. And as you can imagine, that depressed us a bit.
Yes.
And then Edward I, nasty man, went around building all these castles to keep the Welsh in check. And then all the Welsh had to live outside the castle walls, were definitely not allowed in. Inside here, in the 13th century and onwards, would be only English people. So that made us feel quite inferior. You can imagine, can't you?
Amazing. It's extraordinary.
Edward I wanted to stamp out the Welsh language because I can see his reasoning. If you have your own language, you've still got that pride, haven't you?
Absolutely.
So if you stamp it out, if you just, you know,
yeah,
assimilate, make us English as well. But he didn't succeed, did he? We're still here.
You're still here and talking Welsh.
Yeah, and we're allowed in the castle now as long as we pay.
But it seems Edward's dastardly dream almost came true. Even 50 years ago, the Welsh language was still on the back foot. A touring motorist like me might have heard Welsh being spoken, but they'd have been hard-pressed to read it anywhere.
If you'd been driving around here in the 50s, English would still have been the official language. All the signs, everything, you know, menus, whatever, would have been in English. Mm-hmm. The fact that they're Welsh now is quite a recent thing, because I I'm not that old, and I remember it was quite difficult to buy a birthday card in Welsh.
Oh, really?
It really was. Everything was in English.
Even
now,
in the 50s?
In the 50s and 60s, even the 70s.
Really?
It's very recent. Basically, we've got more pride now. Would you like a lesson now? That I could teach you how to say Carnarvon Castle in Welsh.
All right.
Castle is castell.
Castell.
Hey, you've just got the hardest sound in Welsh almost right. The double
castell.
L. Oh, no, that's a ch. It's a double L. You just put your tongue against the back of your teeth there.
Say it again.
You put your tongue against
no,
the
back. No, I say the say the name.
Castell.
Castell.
Castell. Castell Carnarvon.
Castell Carnarvon.
Is that what I sound like?
Clearly, I've got some way to go before I master the Welsh language. So, Bethan has offered to continue my lesson en route to the next stop on my journey, Anberis, the gateway to the mountains. Little does she realize what she's letting herself in for.
You're taking your life in your hands.
After 30 years of driving automatics, I've discovered that me, hills, and classic cars aren't exactly the perfect mix.
Did they have roundabouts in the 50s?
No, I don't suppose they did.
Oops.
Right, I'm glad you're having such a good time, darling.
We have blast off.
When you meet somebody, you want to say hello, won't you?
Yeah.
That's quite easy. Around here, you would say hello.
Hello.
With a, you know,
that's
pronounce
the Welsh. With yeah, hello. Hello.
But how are you? Is Simai.
Simai. Yeah.
Hello, Simai.
Hello, Simai. Hello, how are you?
Yeah. Da is good.
Da.
Da.
Da is good.
And very good is da iawn.
Da iawn.
Yeah. Okay. So you ask me how I am.
Hello, Sumai.
Hello, Sumai. Da iawn, diolch. Hello, iawn, diolch. Yeah, you just, you know, keep on like that.
Hello, Sumai.
Hello. Oh, hello, sut ydych chi?
Hello, Sumai.
Great.
Hello, Sumai.
Your accent is perfect.
What is the Welsh for tail back?
I would say cynffon, which means tail. It's not bad.
What's about 2 miles?
I can safely say it's not the easiest language in the world. So it's with some relief that we reach our destination.
Ah, this is Clanberis, we're here.
Clanberis.
Just in time for a downpour.
Oh, look, it's pouring. I'm sorry.
So you're kicking me out in the rain?
I've got a bus timetable.
Oh, thank you.
Somewhere.
Of course, my guidebooks have warned me about the weather.
Bye.
In the mountains, a few miles can make a big difference. The rainfall at Clanberis, for instance, is close to 100 inches a year. At Carnarvon, less than 10 miles away, it is not much more than a third of that.
It's into those unpredictable and dramatic mountains that I'm now heading, and the next part of my drive brings me face to face with a sight that is as awesome today as it must have been 50 years ago.
Extraordinary view of the vast slate quarry here, stretches for miles.
One of the most conspicuous features of Llanberis is the great De Norwick slate quarry on the opposite side of the lake. It rises in step-like terraces for some 1,800 feet, and the smoke from the locomotives as they ply along the galleries where work is in progress affords one of the best indications of the immensity of the undertaking.
De Norwick was one of the largest slate quarries in the world, and 50 years ago, the valley would echo to the great explosions that freed the slate from the rock. At its height, 3,000 men toiled on the side of this great mountain. And not surprisingly, the quarry dominated life in the local communities. In 1959, local lad Derek Jones was doing his apprenticeship here, just like so many of his friends, neighbours and family had.
Your father and your grandfather and everybody used to work.
It was in the family.
It was in the family, yeah.
So when you were at school, did you think of doing anything else?
Well, no, to be honest. I wanted to follow my father's footsteps and be a quarryman,
right,
to be honest with you.
And was your grandfather a quarryman?
Yes, he was, yeah.
Right.
Yes. Yeah.
And was it a dangerous job?
Oh, yes, quite dangerous, yeah. There was many accidents.
And it would appear some of the dangers may have been due to quarrymen trying to cut costs. And when you discover why, it's hardly surprising.
You had to pay for everything. You had to pay for your powder and fuse wire.
Really?
And yes.
What?
Even all your tools, you had to pay for them.
Well, the company sold it to you?
Yes. And when you wanted your tools sharpening, like your knife or your chisels and things, you took them to the smithy, and you had to pay him even for them to be sharpened.
Amazing.
Up for you. Yes. You even had to pay for the rope that the quarrymen were hanging from. Aye. Because it costs so much, the fuse. You know, people try to make a shortcut sometimes, you know, and which was very dangerous.
Very dangerous.
Yeah. If they could have got away with using a shorter fuse, which had meant they had more for the next time, you know,
yeah,
they would have done, but...
Yes.
Yes.
It's surprising they paid you at all, really, isn't it?
But to Norwich is no longer the hive of activity described in my 1950s guidebooks. In 1969, after 200 years, the quarry was closed due to falling demand, leaving this breathtaking but eerie sight.
When the quarry closed, it must have affected the amount of work available.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. There were so many people wanting to find work after that, you know.
Thousands would be out of work.
Well, yeah, it affected the community as a whole, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
You might as well say killed the community life,
yes,
in the village, you know.
Yeah.
Because it was such a happy place to work in.
Yeah.
Know?
Yeah.
Although it was hard work, everybody knew one another.
Yeah.
And they were all happy together, you know.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
The great Welsh quarries, like so much of Britain's heavy industry, are pretty much all redundant now. But what's interesting is how, although it was tough, dirty, often grueling work, people still look back on them fondly. These huge employers, it seems, acted like a glue that bonded whole communities together. Leaving the quarry behind, I'm now headed for one of the highlights of my drive, the mighty Llanberis Pass.
I can see the pass ahead now. It does look quite dramatic.
The finest mountain road in Wales. Shattered masses of every form, which have fallen from the heights, lie in strange confusion. On the sunniest of days, it is a wild scene. In cloudy or stormy weather, a scene of utter desolation.
The rock wall looks as though some sort of giant has just come along and chipped it all up. It's just millions of individual rocks. I suppose it's been like that since the glacial times. Everything looks like just strewn with rocks.
Not surprisingly, the area is popular with climbers, and many believe that modern rock climbing was born here in the 1950s. I've come to meet an extraordinary chap who knows these mountains like the back of his hand. Solo climber and base jumper, Eric Jones, a man for whom safety ropes are a mere trifle.
So, how old are you, if you don't mind me asking?
I'm now 71.
71?
Yes.
And are there lots of 70-year-old climbers?
Not very many, no.
Yeah.
No.
If you fell now, you could do yourself serious damage.
Don't tell me that.
No, I shouldn't. Is it harder coming down than going up?
Yes, yes. It's hard to see where.
Because you've got to look backwards.
Yeah. Especially on this rock where the holes tend to be a little bit sloping.
So what sort of rock would you call this?
A big rock.
Oh my goodness. Have you always got three bits of your body in contact?
Well, that's the way when you learn to climb. That's the system you use, always have 3 points of contact. But if you're doing a hard climb, that's not possible always.
Yeah.
Maybe you've got to hold just one hold and then just launch yourself. So the 3 points of contact really is only for beginners.
Back when he was a mere slip of a lad at 61, Eric base jumped from the world's highest waterfall, just one of his many achievements. He was also the first British climber to solo the north face of the Matterhorn. He's conquered the Eiger on his own and naturally beaten the hardest climbs in the mighty Llanberis Pass.
The word danger seems to spring to mind quite a lot. Is danger an adrenaline buzz for you?
Yes, I must admit it is a factor because I think it is for everybody, or most people who do these sports, because if climbing was completely safe or if parachuting was completely safe, it wouldn't be as popular, I'm sure.
No, I'm sure. And did you start around here?
I started down in the Llanberis Pass here.
Yeah.
This place, you know, has really special memories for me. You know,
right.
The magic days.
Yes, yes. And amongst climbers, is this a testing area in North Wales?
Oh, for certain, yeah, yes. I mean, I think I'm biased, but I would say it's the best area in the country.
Right.
Although Scottish climbers would disagree with that, I'm sure, but it is pretty unique.
What a remarkable chap Eric is. I mean, having to drive without a seatbelt is enough of an adrenaline fix for me, let alone dangling by my fingertips from the top of these mountains. But I can understand why Eric's heart belongs here. Quite apart from its obvious challenges, it really is an enchanting place and a stunning drive.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, extraordinary. And so instead of all this rock, we now have green, lush hills. Spectacular. Ah, wonderful. Wonderful view. I think it's time to get out and have a look. As far as you can see is sheep, little dots of sheep up here, all the way down the valley.
I don't feel prone to say anything else, other than bloody lovely. My route now takes me down the long valley of Nant Gwynant towards a famously pretty village.
Beth Gellert rivals Betsy Coed for the honour of being the loveliest village in Wales.
But nowadays, the villages of Beth Gellert are encountering a uniquely 21st century problem, unimaginable in the 1950s.
Well, of course, in this modern day, we've got these monster trucks, monsters that come here, and these roads weren't built for that, these bridges.
So why do they come this way?
The old sat-nav, as we call it. Sat-nav.
Yeah. Sat-nav.
Sat-nav, they send them this way.
So they send them here.
They do, unfortunately.
And they wouldn't have thought to come here without a sat-nav.
I'm sure they wouldn't. I'm sure they wouldn't have picked up a map and looked which route to come through the mountains of Snowdonia. They think it's a shortcut, but it's not.
It's not.
They get stuck in every corner going, I think.
The bridge gets battered about a bit.
It does, unfortunately. You see, these two bridges in Beth Gellert are some of the most beautiful bridges in Wales. They're listed buildings.
All right.
And these monster lorries, they pull them down, destroying them. It's very, very sad.
Perhaps there's something to be said for navigating the old-fashioned way. No need for a map to my next destination, though. Beth Gellert's famous ice cream shop with its seemingly limitless choice of flavors.
What about passion fruit sorbet?
Yep, sounds beautiful.
Okay. Hi. Could I have a passion fruit sorbet, but could I have two cones? Do you mind?
Yep.
I want to split it. That's right, two small ones.
Yep.
What one do you sell most of?
Vanilla.
Let's see. I'm sharing it with Ian and the camera here. Have you tasted it, Ian? Who would like to share a raspberry pavlova with me? I wasn't going to have any ice cream, and I ended up having two. C'est la vie. It is Saturday.
The final part of my route leads through even more glorious countryside on the home leg back towards where I started in Carnarvon. But rather than end my journey there, I've decided on a little detour in order to take three ladies on a trip down memory lane.
Good morning.
Here comes.
Are you going our way?
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
I think you'll have to tell me where to go.
Linda, Nora, and Doreen all worked at this holiday park back when it was the pride of Billy Butlin's empire 50 years ago.
Good night, campers. See you in the morning.
And that was on the tannoy.
No. Wherever you were, in
everyone
sang
it.
Butlin's Pwcheli dominated the holiday industry in 1950s North Wales, and on weekends the roads would frequently be clogged by coaches filled with thousands of holidaymakers in search of that special Butlin's magic.
Everybody who came to Butlin's came to have a good time.
Yeah.
And they did.
Yes. Yeah.
And we were here to make sure they did.
It was real good, honest,
innocent fun.
Yes.
Well, do you remember the times we used to have down here with
competitions? Nobbly knees.
Nobbly knees.
Glamorous grandmothers.
It was nobbly knees for men. That was men, wasn't it?
Of course. Yes.
There was lots of romances amongst the staff.
Oh, yes.
I think so,
during the season.
Yes. I think there were seasonal affairs, you know.
Yes,
and
lots of filtered
out until next year. Maybe rekindled or maybe move on, you know.
With Rory Storm and the Hurricane.
Oh, yes.
And Ringo Starr.
He was here.
Ringo Starr was here, wasn't
yes.
he?
Yes, he was.
With his old band, though, before he joined the Beatles.
All right.
That I actually went out with Ringo while I was here.
Oh.
He was a boyfriend.
What could have been, you see?
It's my claim to fame. We used to have parties on the beach.
Yes, what, at night?
Yes, midnight.
Midnight parties.
Midnight parties, yes.
Yes.
Sometimes you went swimming at night, which really, I suppose, was quite dangerous.
You didn't go skinny dipping, did you?
I can't admit to doing that, no.
But I won't admit to doing that.
But you might have.
We might have, but I can't remember that far back.
Neither can I.
Of course we did.
The girls clearly had a ball working and living on the camp. And like so many of the people I've met on my journey so far, they have a real affection for the 1950s.
But you all seemed to have a very good time. You enjoyed yourselves.
We did. We didn't have much, but what we had, we all enjoyed. It was a fabulous time. We made the most of what we had.
Would you say that the 50s were a better time by and large?
Yes.
It seemed safer.
Safer.
Yes. There wasn't the worries about leaving people or meeting people.
Yeah.
So it was a lot nicer in that respect.
Yeah, so you were saying. Yeah.
Didn't want their designer things. They just got what they could afford and they
made the most
everything.
Of it, really.
Yeah.
But because we're talking really the 50s, we're still recovering from the war years.
Yeah. Yes. So, and of course, you were very young then.
Yes.
Yeah, we were.
Don't remind us.
Yeah. Sweet 18. Well, Richard, as a little memento for your trip here in your vintage car, that's a Butlin's Holiday Camp badge from 1958.
Oh, that's lovely. Thank you very much.
A little memento for you.
I put that on.
There we are.
There you are. Now a camper.
You're a camper now.
Not a camper.
Hi. Not
yeah,
a camper,
but
a camper.
I better find a chalet.
Despite the fact that back then we were obviously less well off, it seems it's a spirit of optimism and that very real sense of community that the girls truly cherished from the 50s. Something, I suppose, epitomized by those Butlin's glory years. It's true to say that much of that has faded over the past half century, but this trip has also shown me that it would be naive to consider all progress bad.
Well, that's the end of our Welsh drive, one of the best drives in Britain. There's very little doubt about that. I think the thing to take away from here, of course, is the scenery, the wonderful Welsh scenery. The other thing I think I take away is that, although it was many years ago when I was here last, there seems to be much more pride in the country than I remember. And they've got every right to be. It's a very beautiful country and it's been a very beautiful drive. And certainly, one of the best in Britain.